Today we're going to check out new wave types and look at some of the behaviors and properties of some of these waves. So let's get started.
When we talk about internal waves, we're talking about waves that exist on a surface or an interface where there's big differences in density. Internal waves are usually about 100 meters depth or at the picnic line, a point where the density changes abruptly. Waves at depth can travel independently of those on the surface of the ocean. In other words, they can have different direction, speed, and wavelength as those on the surface. Seiche are waves that slosh around in bays or lakes or any relatively enclosed water environment. Seiche is often caused by earthquakes where the frequency of shaking is low enough such that it matches the resonance of the bay and creates a standing wave. Sometimes wind or atmospheric conditions are exactly right, resulting in enough water to be pushed against the side of the basin to allow a seiche to form. And this happens in Lake Erie or many other large lakes. Seiche can also form below the surface as internal waves. When we look at some of our next waves, we have to consider the wave properties of reflection, refraction, and diffraction. Now, reflection is the property of waves to bounce off a barrier, like a shoreline or a cliff, at the same angle as the angle of incidence. Usually, the reflected wave is a smaller height than the incoming wave because some of the energy has been absorbed by the shoreline or coast. When the reflected wave heads back out to sea, it will intercept the incoming waves and produce an instantaneous large wave crest that's the superposition of the two waves. Refraction, on the other hand, is the bending and slowing of waves due to changes in water depth. So incoming waves will shorten their wavelength, but since the period remains the same, they have to decrease their speed as the orbitals are feeling the bottom near the shoreline. Waves that approach the coast at an oblique angle will bend until they nearly run parallel with the shoreline. Now, diffraction is a different phenomenon. It's the propagation of a wave around the tip of an object like a peninsula or island. While you'd expect a shadow zone behind the object, the waves turn into the area behind the island because the wave height cannot drop to zero instantly. As waves engulf and move around an object like an island, they eventually meet on the backside where a reinforcement of the wave crest occurs through constructive interference. And quite often you'll see a combination of diffraction with refraction, since the depth of water next to an island varies. Tsunami are another waveform that strike both fascination and fear in everyone. These waves are often inappropriately called tidal waves, but have no relation to tides. The word tsunami, in fact, is a Japanese name meaning harbor wave or seismic sea wave. Tsunami are created when there's an event that produces a mound or displacement of water that propagates outward. This displacement can be caused by an asteroid impact, a displacement of the sea floor, by an earthquake, or even a submarine landslide. So let's look at how a landslide can trigger a tsunami. When material on a submarine hillside moves downhill, it leaves a void that's filled by a drop in the sea surface. By the same token, the area where the landslide material has accumulated results in a rise in the ocean surface. This forms a wave that only has to move out from this point on. In the case of earthquakes, where one tectonic plate overrides another, the vertical motion of the seafloor forces the water upward, creating a wave that will move out in all directions. So for places like the Aleutian Islands in Alaska, it would take about 12 hours for the wave to travel to Hawaii, where tsunami go at about 500 miles an hour with wavelengths on the order of 100 miles and heights of only 1 meter in the open ocean. As these waves approach the shoreline, you'd see them reduce their speed and wavelength, yet their height can grow to a gigantic 20 or 30 meters. Now, the largest wave on record was actually due to a landslide that plummeted into Latoya Bay after the 1958 magnitude 8.3 Fairweather earthquake in Alaska. It's the largest wall of water in human history, where the wave removed full-grown pine trees 1,700 feet above the shoreline. Well, that wraps up our episode on waves. As you can see, ocean waves are a complex yet fascinating phenomenon.
Our final note is a precautionary note. If you see the tide retreat a long way out unexpectedly, or if you feel strong ground shaking, then please hightail it to high ground as soon as possible. If you don't see any high ground, then get at least a mile from the shoreline. Your life could depend on it. I'm Mike Kozik, and this is your Science Blast.